looking for the King of Podcasts? You're at the wrong channel. Looking for good ideas for life? You are far from good hands. If you think the listener is always right, you are far from the right place. Hosted by a Northeasterner by birth, a rebel by choice. If you want a host that floats between love and madness, then play on and listen to Crazy Train Radio.
What up?
Excuse me while I whip this out.
Oh, gnarly!
Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you, motherfucker. Say what one more goddamn time.
I knew it. I'm surrounded by assholes.
Good evening, friends!
With over 30 years of experience and a superb reputation for being a detail-oriented company, Lacey Cleaning has some of the highest work standards in the cleaning business.
That's the fact, Jack!
Whether it's carpet cleaning, tile, grout cleaning, new construction cleanup, rental turnovers, vent and duct cleaning, odor elimination, office and or business cleaning, power washing, residential cleaning, you name it, they do it.
Woo!
Check them out. To contact them today, lacycleaning@gmail.com or call them at 609-709-8536.
And that's what I'm talking about.
Are you annoyingly even-keel? Emethamine could be right for you.
I have a disease, all right? I need help!
Emethamine lets you get gacked up on whooped chicken parts without yellowing one's teeth.
Yeah.
Contact your doctor today if you experience the following.
Oh my God!
Increases in blood flow, boost in testosterone, ending of erectile dysfunction. This medicine is made for extreme cases of being even keel or having extreme depression.
Ah, come on!
Side effects include fits of rage, acne, bleeding in folks around you, whooping cough, hallucinations, comas, trouble swallowing, decrease in semen, increasing amounts of selling yourself, amnesia, night terrors, higher mortgage rates, and increased sensations in not having suicidal urges.
Oh my.
Hi there, this is Barbie Wilde. I'm best known for playing the Female Cenobite in Hellbound, Hellraiser 2. You're listening to Crazy Train Radio.
A little surprise here. Well, we'll have a couple surprises on two different episodes here. We traveled up to Cherry Hill, New Jersey, up from Florida again, which is just as human. What the hell was I thinking? But anyway, we are sitting here at Monster Mania out by the pool, waiting for our martinis with Canadian-born British actress, Barbie Wilde. Now, Barbie is best known for being a Cenobite in the Hellraiser series. However, in doing some research, you know, like I was saying there before we start recording, being able to read and write and doing some homework there, I think you're the first mime I've ever had on in 7 years.
I'm actually doing mime, but you guys can't see it. No, it's just, you know, padding imaginary walls was something I was doing when I first moved to the UK. Back in the 70s, because I went to mime class and met my partner, who was my partner for 4 years, Tim Dry,
yes,
whose claim to fame is that he played a couple different characters in the third Star Wars movie, Return of the Jedi, and he was the monster in Extra, don't know if you've seen it. One of the first people in NASA.
I've seen parts, yes.
And we were part of the largest professional mime company in the UK.
Silence, correct?
Silence. That, oh, good, yeah. And then we did something called Drawing in Space. And then we met a guy called Robert Perino and his girlfriend, L.A. Richards, and they saw us doing our mime, and they were sort of disco dancing. They said, why don't we combine forces? And we had a couple other people join us, and we became a group called Shock. And we did mime and music. We had a recording deal with RCA and released a couple of singles and got a lot of publicity and supported people like Gary Newman and Adam and the Ants.
Thank you.
Depeche Mode, yeah. And it was a wonderful, you know, early 80s. I was on the cover of Avant-Garde Hair with my blue hair. And it was, you know, it was an enormous amount of fun. But then we sort of spectacularly split up. And Tim and his sort of mime partner, Sean, went on to do something called Tick and Talk. And they were on British TV and did a lot of stuff.
Now, is this where...
And then I went, tried a singing career, didn't work out. So we turned to acting.
So you mentioned Tick there.
Yeah.
And I was...
Who is Tick? Yeah, Tick.
Yes,
dry.
Well... I was going to mention, would this be the one routine? Because I actually had it pulled up earlier, but my Wi-Fi ain't working out here. Beautiful English, I know, folks.
Yeah.
So there was a bit you did as a mime in space. Would that be the Tick that I'm thinking?
Yes, yes. We were a robotic, very famous, it's a TV show called Seeing and Doing. And we were robotic cleaning crew.
Yes.
And I looked magnificent in pink lycra, and he was wearing this pink sort of, you know, boiler suit. I don't know what they can call them over here anymore. But no, that was the thing. And also, but you know, one of my major claims to fame, other than Hellraiser and Death Wish 3, was that I was on a kids' TV show with another girl, and we called ourselves Technical Glamour. And this is like one of the most famous TV shows in the UK. It's called Sooty. Mm-hmm. And Sooty was a little puppet. And we taught Sooty, Sweep, and the third one, these little hand puppets, how to robotically mime. And it's a really cute thing. But I got more recognition for that than supporting Gary Newman at Wembley.
Well, I'm thinking of the other bit, and it's funny because the videos I had pulled ready to actually show you, you actually posted. The second video that I'm thinking of and had pulled was the old bit from the 80s song.
Putting on the Ritz?
Thank you. To put on the Ritz, yes. It was in my notes here.
That's the other thing I did.
In the pink dress, blue hair again,
yes.
Folks.
It was a pink clown costume,
yes.
Actually. It seemed like such a good idea. It was the 80s. And that was with very venerable comedians called Morton and Wise. They were enormous in the UK.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was so much fun doing that routine, and they were just really adorable. And then I ended up doing some promotional things with them later, a couple years later, and just they were so much fun to work with.
Now, obviously, for most folks, and I get it a little bit, but I'm not very well schooled in it, differences in British comedy to American comedy.
Oh, yeah.
And certain folk, yeah, there's big differences, folks. And most people here in America, would, when you think British comedy, think of somebody like a Benny Hill. But where
yes.
Would, yes, and I'm familiar with the duo. I would say they're almost like the 80s version of an old duo we had in America called Abbott and Costello.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So where would you rank these gentlemen as far as when it comes to British comedy and where they peck in
history? I would say that it was, God, it's so difficult.
And obviously everybody's opinion is different. But
sure. Morgan Wise, put them out. I mean, I suppose in many ways Abbott and Costello, because they're a duo.
Yeah.
I can't really think of any American duos other than Abbott and Costello, actually.
But that's why, yeah, I use that reference.
Yeah, but it is very much like that. But they were sort of more almost like mime artists. With Eric and Ernie, they were just really very funny, very, used language brightly. I mean, they had everybody on their show. I mean, Peter Cushing, the horror icon, continually came back on the show demanding his £20 retainer fee and all this sort of stuff. So it was, I can't tell you how big they were. They were on the TV for like 8 to 10 years or something. Yeah. They were massive. And they did movies as well.
Well, and you said it there before we get into the horror genre here. And it works with any kind of comedy, I would think, whether you're talking the British comedy, American comedy, wherever you're at, and whatever style you're performing, being very articulate with the words is key.
Yeah.
And how you play with the words to make the topic you're working on funny. Would you agree with that?
I think so, yeah. I mean, there, you know, you get comedians like Mr. Bean, who never says anything. And he's physical comedy, and that's very much like, you know, the comedians like Buster Keaton. Love him. I had such a huge crush on him after seeing The General, Harold Langdon, all these people who were actually, they didn't use any words at all. It was all like physical comedy and the scenarios that they used. But I love the sort of, if you can create language and make funny jokes and stuff like that. That's, you know, one of my favorite comedians who sadly passed away is Bill Hicks.
Yes.
And he to me, I just never saw anybody like him. And
Bill was a unique bird, and I mean that with all
due respect. Really, really unique. And when you think, even though he died at 33, I think, He had been working for 20 years. He started doing stand-up when he was 13, which is amazing.
Yeah.
But he was special. His take on the world was so unique.
Now, most comics and folks in the entertainment ones, in the entertainment world, successful ones like that, many people don't realize how bright they are.
Yeah.
What's going on around, whether it be news or however, you know, because obviously you got to study a lot of what's going on in the world to be on the pulse of things.
Yeah. Well, I think that's why, you know, I'm probably getting ahead of myself here. I read a lot, I watch a lot of news and all this sort of stuff. So when I was writing my books, and, you know, I did a lot of research, especially for the serial killer one. And because I wanted it to be real.
Yeah.
And it's sort of like, I mean, the finest actors always do a huge amount of research to and even actually go through training to be an astronaut or do scuba diving or something like that. So they know what they're doing and they feel comfortable with it. And they look like they are real scuba divers or, you know,
astronauts, whatever the case may be.
Whatever the case may be. So it's all part of the sort of process of acting. Although there's nothing to prepare you for being a demon from hell.
No, but you brought up the books real quick, and that brings up something I was thinking about too, because you've done acting, you've done mime work, you've done writing, you've hosted music TV shows, you know, over in the UK and such. With all the different mediums you've done, do you get joy out of one particular medium compared to another?
I absolutely think that, if you're a bit of a power-hungry maniac like myself, I'm creating my own worlds by my writing. And that's a wonderful feeling. And when it works well, it's really great. When it doesn't work well, when you have writer's block, it's torture. But I think that, you know, I did some acting, it's a couple of years ago now, for this TV series called Dark Ditties, and I'm going to be doing another episode this autumn. And I hadn't acted in 17 years. And it was like, oh no, this is going to be really scary. But it was fun. It was great. We had a lovely time. I froze my toes off, but we were in this old abbey. But it was great to be back, but I I do love writing and writing scripts and stuff like that, because I think that that's something, it's very creative. And as an actor, you're, of course, you have to create the character, but you're still, these are someone else's words and ideas and stuff. And that's what I like about it.
But do you get the same creative energy as far as like we'll use Hellraiser here, which is what you're here for Monster Mania for, most people know you for.
Yeah.
But do you get that same performer's energy? You know what I mean? Like, okay, I'm getting ready to do take one, take two. Compared to writing, because you don't get that instant.
The terror is not there.
But no.
The adrenaline isn't there. But when you finish something and you go, oh my God, this really works, and then you read it to your ideal reader. I'm lucky enough to have my husband. And he goes, wow, that's his reaction. Then you think, yes, this is working. It's a much quieter kind of thing. But when you go through the hell of it's all to do with, like, how do you motivate yourself? And that's very difficult. But one of my favorite movies is Galaxy Quest.
Okay.
Because I'm a Star Trek fan. And Commander Taggart says to his crew, we must never give up, never surrender. And that's when you're doing something self-motivating, like writing, like anything, directing or trying to create something, you have got to never give up and you never surrender. And I've got a lot of work to do, but it's sort of like, you know, the world gets in my way sometimes and I let it. And, you know, the passion, you have to keep that passion aflame, you know, on fire, because otherwise it's very difficult to continue, because you think, oh, will anybody ever read my book? But you know, I'm just getting on for my serial killer book, which is called The Venus Complex.
We'll put a links to Amazon underneath on the YouTube version and in the email blast as well too. So
yeah, I mean, just as another plug.
Yeah, no, it's plug. Fine.
When Doug Bradley, who plays
Pinhead,
or the lead Cenobite, or whatever you want to call him, Hell Priest. He did the audiobook of The Venus Complex, and it's basically a diary of a serial killer from the male viewpoint, exploring his sexual fantasies. And Doug did such a magnificent job. Let me say smoothly sinister or something, one of the reviews said. And that was so exciting to me, because I've been dreaming of somebody making a movie of The Venus Complex. But hearing Doug's voice, because it was always me reading it out, and I'm just this like little blonde lady reading out this, you know, this is a guy. And hearing his performance of it was just enrapturing. And you think, this is the next step to a movie or something happening with this.
And that's the funny thing is, I met Doug and we had him on briefly for a few minutes. Down, he had an appearance in Atlantic City several years ago. And I don't know what it is. Very intelligent man. But Doug, there's just something about the man that's so intriguing. And then, like you said, the articulate, being articulate, the voice, there's just something about the man that I don't know what it is.
It's called charisma.
Yeah.
And he's a brilliant actor and an incredibly intelligent person. He gave me $15 to say that. No, he didn't really. Who knew what
he said. The check bounced, folks. We're kidding.
No, but he's very intelligent. When I was basically directing him, he would come in with queries and I would say, you know, do it this way, do it that. But for the most part, I really didn't need to, because he was just so spot on. I would listen to him, and he also did a huge amount of, hey, you know, that's spelled wrong, or no, you actually did that wrong, and I was like, oh my God, he's a better editor than my editor, bless her, who's wonderful. But, you know, it's he's very, very, the performance he gives is based in his intelligence and realizing that the male character that I created, Michael Friday, was also a very intelligent serial killer. But when I was interviewing a police detective in New York, he just finished a serial killer case, you know, and this guy was dumb as a sack of hair, right?
Yeah.
He was caught after like three killings, you know. And it's interesting because it's sort of amongst serial killers are amongst the population. You only get about 5 or 10% of ones that are just fiendishly clever. And there are no Hannibal Lecters, really. But sometimes because of whatever problems, they do escape capture for many, many, many years. But those are the ones that are in that top percentile.
Yeah.
And most of the other ones get caught fairly rapidly because they just don't. I haven't watched enough Hawaii 5.0 episodes to know the fingerprints, man.
Yeah, go figure. In 2019, you know.
Okay.
But, you know, let's go over to Hellraiser because don't want to spend too hot or too much time out here in the heat.
Yes, I'd rather melting.
Yeah, we'll put the clip of Wicked Witch in there. what the hell? So, obviously, Clive Barker's here at the event as well.
Yeah.
And fabulous writer, creator of many different genres like yourself. But when you were, and you were a part of too, Hellbound, but when you see the script, and obviously you've probably seen the first movie prior to filming and getting ready to go, what is your take on, what was your take, I should say, on the project then, and what's your take on it now, all these years later?
Well, it's interesting because everybody went to see Hellraiser because a lot of fuss was made. You know, Stephen King said, you know, I've seen the future before, and it's Clive Barker. And I was so disturbed by this film. And I was like, whoa, this is really odd. Oh, my God, Cenobites, you know. And so when the call came a year later, I nearly didn't go to the audition. I said, I don't want to be in this movie. A, I thought I was going to be playing the Chatter, and I hate mask work. I did some mask work. In when I was in my Mime days, and I thought, oh, I don't want to pay. A, he's really creepy looking, and B, ugh, claustrophobic. And they said, no, it's for the female Cenobite. I went, oh, okay. But then my friend Jeff, God bless him, he said, oh, go on, Barbie. 20 years from now, they'll be writing books about Chuck. Barbie Wilde, Queen of the Bee movies, because I had done the film with, you know, all my movies have numbers after the titles. So I went to the audition, and you know, had a chat to Tony Randall, and I got the part. I'm not quite sure why. It could have been my mime training, because they have a feeling that people who are trained in mime are, A, it's all about the stillness, it's not about the movement, but also, you know, they're more long-suffering under the makeup, which isn't necessarily true in my case. But I think that the seeing one and two especially, and to be honest, I haven't seen any of the other ones, I feel that they are extraordinary works. I think Clive is a genius. But what I love about, in one of the titles, they said, oh, we're not so sure about, you know, the Hellbound Heart, and what can we call it, you know, Hellraiser or whatever. And Clive said, why don't we just call it Sadomasochists from Hell? And you have to admit, but he created a new kind of monster. Not everybody can do that, that has any lasting ability. The Cenobites are a new kind of monster. But of course, the real monsters are Julia and Frank, you know. And I think in the character of Julia, Clive created this diva of horror who is a master class, you know. Doug was actually talking about watching.
He's still going to murder circle.
Yeah, oh my God. He's actually was asked to read with Claire. And she, you know, the scene where she's like killing the guys to give Frank their skin and stuff.
Yeah.
She felt this whoosh as the hammer went past his head. He looked up and Clive was going, she's got the part. And it's like the hammer missed her by that much, but she was like, you know, in her element or passion and stuff. I think it holds up very well. I mean, maybe people perhaps don't, they're not that maybe convinced by the physical effects, but they certainly were top of the mark at that time. But I think it's the story that really, really continues on and is absolutely it's timeless. And that's why people are here to see us 31 years later, or 32 years later in the case of Hellraiser, and I think it's wonderful. I mean, I have people coming up and saying, you scared the hell out of me when I was 8 years old, and you know what I say to them? what were your parents thinking of? There's a lot of sensitive stuff in here, yeah. You know. But it is, you know, it is wonderful that, you know, people are still intrigued by these films all these years later. And it's, they're not quite as intrigued by my fabulous performance as a female mugger in Deadly 3. I wonder why. But, you know, it's not, these are iconic characters. And it is magical.
Yeah, last question, since we're at a convention, and I'm sure you've seen many a thing. Strangest thing you ever signed at a convention?
Oh gosh, that's two things. One was this sort of rather massive lament configuration lampshade, which is kind of, wow, I wouldn't mind that. And then somebody else brought up, they actually, from photographs, made one of my knives. And I signed it. And I went, wow, can I keep it? And he went, no, you're not going to be selling them on the internet. And I went, oh. But that's the last thing I can think of. Those are the two things that I actually signed somebody's leg. Does that count?
Yeah, no. Because that was just one of those that they got a tattoo afterwards.
Yeah, they had a tattoo of me, and they said, could you sign it? And I was like, going, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I've seen that done too as
yeah.
well.
Yeah, but that was nice because they were so dedicated.
Well, Barbie, website, social media, anything like that, do you have, care to share?
Twitter is at Barbie Wilde. My Facebook page is at Barbie Wilde, or there's Barbie Wilde, author and actress. There's a page for the Venus Complex and by Barbie Wilde, and there's also a page for my short horror story collection, which contains three female Cenobite stories called Voices of the Damned. That's also on Facebook. And of course, I have my website, which is languishing a little bit because I'm a bit of a social media bug.
Yeah, well, we'll put links to everything under the public form of this. So, Barbie, thank you so much.
Thank you. It was a delight talking to you.
Not all football helmets are created equal. Zenith, the industry leader in protective technology, is the only helmet in the game with adaptive head protection featuring a shock suspension system that can move independently from the helmet shell. Headquartered and developed in Detroit, Zenith is committed to player safety and revolutionary innovation. Zenith is proud to protect athletes at every level from peewee to the pros. Learn more about the Zenith difference at zenith.com. That's XENITH.com.
Hi, this is Doug Bradley, Pinhead from the Hellraiser movies, and you're listening to Crazy Train Radio. And you better keep listening or I will tear your soul apart.